Welcome to Real Nature. We're so glad to have you. Is this your first time with us? Look at the back of your bulletin and you'll see Upward. Please fill it out and turn it in to the connections. We would love to pray for you and stay in touch. January 7th is Vision Sunday. We will be casting the vision of Simeon's Spirit Love. Be sure you're in attendance for a special class. And for any first-time guests, next Sunday we will be having Pastor's Birthday on December 31st at 9 a.m. If you would like to participate in giving that remedy, you have several ways to give. Just drop your tithing envelope, fill it out completely, into the boxes located in the sanctuary at the door of the sanctuary. You can also give online by visiting our website at www.remychurchnc.org/online-giving. We hope you enjoy the Christmas program, Our Coming Savior.
Good morning, Remy Church. You may say, Alex, why in the world do you make me do this? Because I want to make sure that you're ready to worship, and there's nothing wrong with clapping and making noise in the kingdom. Amen. Amen. Like the video that interrupted me said, my brother-in-law back there, I think he did it on purpose. When you come in the back, we have some fine people in the back handing out these bulletins. But it says, a Savior is born. If you didn't get this one, then you got the wrong one. So get the right one. But in the back, there's a flap. Everybody see the flap? Nod your head at me and say, I see the flap. Yes. You got them all on camera now. Every one of them said they saw the flap. But it says prayer card. And it is a spot right there that you can write down any kind of prayer request that you may have. You don't have to necessarily put your name on it. Because sometimes people go through things, especially during the Christmas season. And this is a church that wants to partner with you in prayer. And if you would, just have a... take a brief moment, the first time here, regular attenders, fill this out for prayer card, and then there's some generic information down there. We love you, we want you to be a part of this family, and we want to be able to connect with you. And this is a good way for us to stay in contact with you. Is that okay? Amen. Amen. Now, last night, we had a phenomenal crowd, and it doesn't look too much different in here this morning. So I'm going to clap and praise the Lord. If you want to join me, you go ahead. But if not, I'm just going to say thank you. Amen. Hey, listen, it's wonderful for you guys to be here. I'm glad to see each and every one of you. But I got a question. I got a question this morning. How many people in here have a routine? You do something almost all the time where you kind of forget. Like, anybody in here brush your teeth? I had three people raise their hand. So if they say, bless the Lord, somebody does that. It ain't the Holy Ghost. It's probably... All right. So, but brushing your teeth is something that is routine. And there's been times that, you know, you brush your teeth and you're like, can I brush my teeth? Because you do it so much. Do you understand what I'm saying? It becomes a habit that's like, did I do that? Or, you know, did I put my seatbelt on or something like that? Something that constantly happens. And unfortunately, we do the same thing in church. Guys, hit my first verse up there. This is the most common generic verse. This is the verse that atheists know, that don't believe in God, and they can quote it word for word. But this is the story of the greatest love story ever told. And I'm going to explain it. It says, for God so loved the world. Love is past tense. He loved the world that he gave his one and only son. His only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now you may ask, well, why is that the greatest love story? Josh, hit my second one. It said God demonstrated his love for us
that while we were still sinners, Christ came and died for us. Now, forgive my lingo here, but he didn't miraculously come down from heaven into a man. He had to first be born as a baby. And he left heaven. See, I'm going to go ahead and be honest with you. If God goes and takes me home and I go to heaven, I ain't coming back. When I get to heaven, I'm good. Leave this world behind. I want nothing, no part in it. My family's going to be just fine. Because the same God who's taking care of me will take care of my family. But Jesus experienced heaven. And he said, I'm going to go down. And I'm going to spend 33 years at a place filled with hate, religion, racism, the same stuff that we face today. And he says, I'm going to come down and I'm going to go through life only for one purpose, and that is to die for you. But it never would have started had he not came that glorious night when he was a baby in the manger. This wasn't no mistake. So the reason I said that, because sometimes we say Merry Christmas and we go through the motions. So this Christmas season, I would challenge you. When you go home tomorrow, when it's Christmas, and you're with your families, and you're opening up presents in the morning, and kids is filled with joy and laughter, and you see family that you normally don't see, but like once or twice a year. Yeah, I'm being honest here. Is that okay? When you say Merry Christmas, I want you to grab the whole concept of actually what you're saying. And the cool part I like about this is God demonstrated his love towards us while we were still sinners. That means that no matter what you are into today or what you've been a part of, Christ demonstrated his love by sending his son to die just for you. And guess what? He'll do it all over again. Maybe you didn't hear what I said. I said he'll do it all over again. So this morning, as these children and these young adults perform and they minister, my prayer to you today is that you would open up and allow Jesus, the Savior of the world, this baby that was wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger, I would invite you to receive his love unto you today. Amen. Heavenly Father, I love you very much, God. This is your service. This is your time. These are your people. This is not a mistaken accident, but it's a divine appointment for every person that's sitting in here today. And God, as we minister and we testify and glorify your name through song and skits, Father, I pray, God, that the manifestation of your love would hover over this house, Lord Jesus, that you would touch your people inside and out, Lord God, and that you would begin to soften all hearts, Lord God, and all attention will be unto you and given to you today. Father, I love you. I bless your name, and I give you glory for all that's going to happen here this morning. In Jesus' name. Thank you.
Look, I am sending my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Then the Lord you are seeking will suddenly come to this temple. The messenger of the covenant, whom you look for so eagerly, is surely coming, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Malachi 3:9.
The birth of Messiah has been long foretold. Let unto you, let unto you. Born in darkness, seen a great light. The Redeemer of our hearts has been born this night. God unto you, now unto you. Yeshua, Messiah, Son of Man, Holy One, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Great I Am, Comforter, Counselor, Author and Finisher, Divine Truth Redeemer, Together Redeemer, King of God. You are
born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and his peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his commitment, and the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. Isaiah 9, 6, 7.
will.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel of Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think about what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus.
He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. Mary asked the angel, she said, "But how can this happen? I'm a virgin." And the angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. Luke 1:26-38.
Did you know that your baby boy suddenly walked on water? Did you know that your baby boy saved our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? Child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Did you know your baby boy decided to love my man? Baby, did you know your baby boy called the storm with his hand? Your little baby, kiss the face of God. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak.
were the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger." And suddenly there was the angel of multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "The glory to God in the highest, and on earth goodwill toward men." So it was taken, it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, but the angels said to one another, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe laying in the manger. Now, when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told to them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at the things that which were told by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told to them. Luke 2:8-20.
Shelter from the cold night air. Some haste where she could lay her head, where she could give her babe quiet bed. Was there no room, no corner there? In all the town, a spot someone could spare. Was there no soul come to their aid? A stable bear is where the family stayed. Do you have room for the Savior? Do you seek Him anew? Have you a place for the one who lived and died for you? Are you as humble as a shepherd? shepherd boy, or as wise as men of old. Would you have come that night? Would you have sought the light? Do you have room?
Chapter 2, Luke chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. I grabbed the stool because let's all laugh together. I could have said that was planned, but it wasn't. We've had a lot of laughs, a lot of really cool moments as we've described to you today what it looked like at the coming of our Savior. But I want to read for you one more time, Luke chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. It says that Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth, that's Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. We get a very vague passage of Scripture in a lot of ways as to what happened whenever they got to Bethlehem. We see this character, if you want to think about it like a story. We get a character, the innkeeper. We don't know a name. As a matter of fact, it doesn't even mention that the innkeeper met them, but you know, as the profession would have it, there would have been someone who met them at the door, whom they would have checked with, just like if you and I were to walk into a hotel and ask if they had vacancy on a long road trip that we've had, maybe decided to stop. Mary and Joseph were coming into Bethlehem, and they knew the purpose of why they were there. While they were there for a census, and they were there to do what was being asked of them by the government at the time, what they really knew was about to happen was the coming of a Savior, whom they would call Jesus. And the Scripture, with it being vague, it always strikes me funny, but it always rises a question out of my spirit. Have I made room for Him in my life? Have I made room for him? Not just during the Christmas season, because we know how busy the Christmas season can get. We know the hustle and bustle that is all around it, that surrounds the festivities and the get-togethers and the dinners and the present buying and the trips to Walmart. God help us. All of the different things that we do, all of the lighting and the decorations on our homes, all of the traditions that we have, all of the things that we fill up our lives with. We have a tendency to try to fill our lives with something that makes us feel satisfied with this life. But you need to know that you were created for so much more than just stuff. You were created with a significant and specific design. That God, He thought of you before you were in your mother's womb. He formed you and He made you for a purpose in this earth. And I don't know what you've walked in the doors with this morning, or what ideas you've had about Jesus or God, or what His Word says, or even maybe what people who claim to follow Him do or say, because we get it wrong a lot of the time. And a very, very specific message that I preach here at Remedy, and I said this last night, I'm going to say it again, is that we have gotten so far off track as the church. And I think God is calling us back to experience the real love of Jesus Christ. And that real love looks so different than it ever has in some of our churches. Some of our places that proclaim to be the hub of where we see the kingdom of God. Some of the places where people are supposed to experience Jesus first and foremost. We've gotten it wrong. But I want to tell you today that God and the real love that He has for you. He died for you knowing that you would be where you are right at this moment. That there's nothing in your life that's caught Him by surprise. There's nothing in your life that could tear you away from or keep you away from the love that He has for you. You see, before the foundations of the world were laid, Jesus Christ had already been determined as the sacrifice for all mankind so that you and I one day could live evermore with Him in eternity in a place called heaven. And I'm so thankful for the Christmas season. I'm thankful for these moments that we get to share together of a baby that came. Was laid into a manger that we paint as some cute little wooden creation full of hay, but it was most likely in the middle of a hollowed-out cave the side of a mountain, laid on a manger, and a manger is not wooden, but at that time it was made of stone. It was unfit for any human being to lie in or be a part of. It was where the animals were fed. It was a trough made of stone. It was uncomfortable. It was low. It was insignificant. And Jesus came as all of those things. But I'm thankful today that as we celebrate the coming of a baby, we know while the manger held the baby, the grave could not hold the king. That while He came to live 33 years on this earth and die a horrible death, He went from insignificance to being unrecognizable upon a tree that He hung from so that you and I could have eternal life. And He performed physically what we could not, so that spiritually we could gain what we didn't have access to. You need to understand before you walk out of the doors today that Christ desires to know you. That He already loves you, that nothing has taken that away from you, that there is nothing that can tear you from that, that right where you are, no matter what your past is, no matter what your story is, no matter where you come from, who your mom and dad were, what kind of issue you had, what kind of addiction you have, what kind of struggle you have, whatever it is today, Jesus still wants you. And He has a life that you could have never imagined waiting on you should you hand your life to Him. Does that mean everything's going to be easy? No. But what it means is that whenever I get in the stickiness of life, I get in the thick, hard-to-navigate situations of life, I know that there is a person that I can call to that is greater than me, that knows more than me, that has more power than me, that He has everything in His hands, and everything that I see, touch, feel, know, He created all of it. It's His. And I wonder if we're asking the question today to ourselves, have I made room for Him? A great, big, powerful, awesome, all-knowing God, unchanging God, have I made room for Him in the busyness of my life? Can you ask yourself that question this morning? Maybe some of you need to ask, do I really believe that somebody could love me like that? Do I really believe that somebody could love me so much that they would step out from a throne room, from a place more glorious than we've ever seen in our lives, come down to the earth that's imperfect and flawed and messed up, and it is just ridden with everything that God despises, but He came down and was a part of you and I, so that one day me and you could live eternally with Him. But I have to ask you, have you made room? Have you made room for me?